Today I want to give you some basic, large look overview at what we're talking about. David will tell you in a few minutes, or maybe he's already told you, I don't know, about medical standards. This is something that I learned from David. He taught me about how it was 200 years before the use of lime for prevention of scurvy became a standard. It took 100 years for metformin. I looked him up, checked him out on it, and he's right. And at this point, it still takes 20 years or so, 15, 20 years, even in the age of internet. Why is that the case? I've been involved in medical standards. When I was at Hopkins and ran the prevention program, I had my student doctors that I was teaching, did the science reviews for the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force. Those guys sit around the table and have to argue with each other over who should have discovered something, who hasn't, why they haven't. It's a human political process. And they also have to prove that these things are right. So it takes time. Now, there are three areas where the standards have not quite caught up to the science, and that's what we're going to talk about today. One of them has to do with plaque. The next one has to do with insulin resistance, the most common cause of plaque. And the third has to do with inflammation, cardiovascular inflammation, and its proximal most urgent cause of heart attack and stroke. Now, it's not going to be in that order. I'm going to start off with some discussion about inflammation. Then we'll jump around a little bit. Please be patient with me as we do. If you look at Time magazine way back in 2004, they had a cover article on inflammation and its cause of heart attacks, cancer, Alzheimer's, and other critical diseases. If you look at medical magazines, they're still mentioning it, but as we just said, the medical standards have not caught up yet. In fact, most cardiologists do know that there's something about cardiovascular inflammation and it causing heart attack. But this study that came out 2 years ago still caught the world's cardiology leadership flat-footed. The most common thing they said was, you know, I knew that cardiovascular inflammation had something to do with it, but I didn't know this. And this, what they're talking about is Paul Ridker, a very smart guy, cardiologist at Harvard, who's been preaching this inflammation message for decades, actually was able to give a very strong anti-inflammatory medicine used for inflammatory diseases, which we won't go into. But he gave that to people all over the world and actually decreased their heart attack and stroke activities, the rate of heart attack and stroke. So I'm not going to go any deeper in that. I'll just show a picture of Paul Ridker, again, maybe the godfather of cardiovascular inflammation in terms of this space. And the name of the trial was the CANTOS trial. You can see that in Scientific American magazine, as well as the New England Journal that I just talked about. But again, let's focus on what we're here to learn today. First is, do you have plaque? Unfortunately, the standards of medicine are not that great on helping you understand that. And that's the most important first thing to find out. That's why we're having the CIMT tour. I'm going to go quickly through these items and talk about the pros and the cons. Framingham is basically where your cardiologist or your primary care doc will start. It's not a measurement, it's a guess, and it's a bad guess. Then usually most people will say, well, I got a stress test. 5 million stress tests are being done each year. There are a huge number of false positives, as in like 30%, depending on where you get them. And a false positive leads you to the cath lab. There are also, and even worse, a huge number of false negatives. Again, you'll see literature saying up to 30%. Here, the bottom line is with a stress test, it's not going to show you a positive unless you have over 50% blockage of your artery. Well, guess what? 68% of heart attacks and strokes occur in people that don't have 50% blockage of their arteries. Again, that's why we're here looking at CIMT and getting a CIMT. PC angiogram, in other words, percutaneous, going through the skin, and welcome to the cath lab. That's not where we want to go. If we can avoid it, we want to. Calcium score is a big improvement over these. It's a great tool for screening. It's not great for following progress, and there is radiation involved. It's available. It's just not as good as CIMT. CT angiogram is expensive. It's coming out of the blocks now as a very good test. Again, it's expensive, and part of the problem with a CT angiogram is you don't know whether if you see plaque, you don't know whether it's soft or stable. Hence the CIMT. Again, I've mentioned it a couple of times. I'm not going to cover it any deeper today. Todd's going to cover that in his presentation. And again, you've got David here to give you a little bit more detail. I just want to give you the perspective from a physician in terms of the advantages and disadvantages. I did an article, a video recently on ABI, ankle brachial index. It's a great do-it-yourself one, except for the following problem. A negative's not going to tell you that much. And if you have a positive, most people already know their results before they have this test. It's an accurate test. It's a do-it-yourself. It's very inexpensive. But unfortunately, and it's a great test. If you haven't done it for yourself, look it up on my video and do it. Unfortunately, again, you already know most of what you're going to find out from an ABI. I'm going to skip over these questions because we have a lot that I'd like to cover for you today. And let's go again a little bit more deeply into cardiovascular inflammation. First of all, this is where we're going in deeper and deeper in terms of scope or granularity in terms of what's going on and where we're looking, from the heart and cardiovascular system to a single artery, then getting into layers of the arteries, and then getting into glycocalyx. Now, again, very minimal, high-level look, the heart and the arteries. We're looking at the intima and media. The intima is the lining. It's a slick lining, but it has that glycocalyx area. The glycocalyx is sort of like the edge of a marshland. That area where you have marsh next to the river, that's where the real metabolic activities occur, both in our body as well as in the marshland. And this is a picture a cross section of the artery showing that hairy looking glycocalyx. Here's a diagram of the glycocalyx, and here's a healthy glycocalyx, GCX, right here. Now, what happens with inflammation is this. Let's say you are a smoker, or you have inflammatory disease like rheumatoid arthritis, or most commonly, like over half of us as adults, you have insulin resistance. In other words, you eat carbs and your body stays at a 180 or above for hour after hour in terms of your blood glucose level. Look what happens. That tends to destroy that glycocalyx. This is a healthy glycocalyx up here and down here, but here, these are systemic effects occurring from inflammation. Once that happens, it becomes much easier to understand how small dents, LDL, can make it through that hairy glycocalyx and lodge into the cells of the intima and pass through them and lodge into the artery wall. Once that happens, we get inflammation. The body's immune system, you're taking friendly fire. The body's immune system recognizes this plaque and says, this should not be here. It sends in immune cells, T cells, monocytes, polymorphin. I'm not going to name all the different types of cells, but we will talk about two of them a little bit later because we can actually measure their activity. That's part of the inflammation test. all of that's actually not bad because the immune system's doing what it should do. It's liquefying something that shouldn't be there so it can remove it. So this is the cross-section of an artery. This is the media, the muscular layer. This is the intima, the lining with that glycocalyx. And this is plaque that has gotten stuck between the intima and media layers. But here's the problem. Well, one more thing. This is a liquid area. That's why it's sort of retracted away from the slide. Now this hot liquid area, that again, all of that's good up until this point. And here's the problem. You go back to these cells and some of the chemicals that they release can cause a clot if they touch blood. And that's exactly what happened here. This is another view of someone who died from a heart attack, just like this one. And this is a larger view. It's a little bit different preparation. This is the media of the artery wall out here. This is the intima. As you see, there are a couple of broken places. This black thing is not hot plaque. It is the clot that the blood formed when that hot plaque touched the blood. The larger part of this clot is what killed the patient. It floated on up to the heart. And again, this is not plaque. This is, pardon the image there, or the mislabeling. This is the clot that's gone on up into the area where that hot plaque was. Here you see there's another hot plaque pocket right here. So that shows that this is a systemic issue. In other words, it's happening one place in the body, it's happening all over in the body. That's why we can look and tell whether you have hot plaque by looking at your neck instead of your heart. We've actually done studies, so we haven't done them. They've been done many, many times.